Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Andreas Kloos. I'm a PhD student at the Fernuniversität in Hagen, and I'm very pleased to present you our current research. Today we are going to talk about emergency landing field identification based on a hierarchical sample transfer learning model. The presentation is structured as follows. First, I will give a motivation why it is important to conduct an emergency landing field identification. Second, I will talk about the generated datasets. Third, we will see the preparatory analysis and the results, which are necessary to develop the sample model, which we will get to know afterwards. Then we will speak about the results and discuss them. And last but not least, we will conclude the presentation and give an outlook on our future works. Let's move to the motivation. Imagine there's a beautiful sunny summer day, as shown in this picture. It's perfect weather conditions and you flying in general aviation aircraft, as shown in this picture. You enjoy the smooth weather and relax this flying, and suddenly your engine bursts and you figure out there is a total loss of trust. In this situation, you, as a pilot, you are forced to conduct an emergency landing. And it is not always guaranteed that there is an official, published, in the best case paved, runway. In some situation, the pilot is forced to search visually in proper emergency landing field, which depicts the lowest risk for himself, of course, for the passengers on board, and of course the population on the ground. It is also not always guaranteed to have perfect weather conditions, as shown in this picture. Sometimes you have conditions like this. You have minimal visual flight conditions, and it is very, very hard, even if not impossible, to find a proper emergency landing field in this case. This is why we think it's very important that the pilot gets supported by a database which delivers in an emergency situation possible emergency landing fields, so that even under these worst conditions, the pilot can safely fly to an emergency landing field and conduct there the emergency landing. Our approach is based on neural networks, and therefore we generated a dataset or several datasets, as shown in this slide. On the left side, you can see we created three datasets with three different search sizes. We call it or search window sizes: 8 square meters, 16 square meters, and 32 square meters. And each dataset have different number of training and testing samples, ranging from 380,000 training samples to about 16,700 training samples, and from about 76,000 test samples to about 3,300 test samples. Each dataset is composed of several data layers, which are shown here on the right side. In figure A, you see the RGB or color channels of a not landable sample. And you see in figure B, there is the near-infrared channel shown. From those both layers, we calculated the normalized difference vegetation index, which is shown in figure C. In figure D, there is the interpolated digital surface model shown. From this data layer, we calculated a roughness map, which is shown in figure E. And in figure F is shown a slope map, which is also calculated based on the interpolated digital surface model. Based on this dataset, we trained several networks and performed some preparatory analysis, which we will see, the results we will see on the next slide. First, we figure out which data composition is the most favorable for each search window size. And you see, we checked here the RGB, NDVI near slope, NDVI roughness slope, and so on and so on. And for a search window size of 8 square meters, we figure out that the RGB near infrared slope data composition achieved the neural network trained on this data achieved the best accuracy values. And I also need to mention that all analyses with the data sets are performed with the same network, namely AlexNet. And for a search window size of 16 square meters, we find out that the NDVI slope data composition was capable, the network trained on this data set, was capable to achieve the highest accuracy values. And for 32 square meters, the RGB slope data composition seemed to be most favorable for training AlexNet on the given problem at hand. The next step was to identify the best performing transfer learning model. As you can see here on the x-axis, we investigated very well-known neural network architectures like InceptionNet, AlexNet, VGG, MobileNet, DenseNet, ShuffleNet, and so on. And for a search window of 8 square meters, we figure out that the ResNet 18 architecture achieved the highest accuracy values. For a search window size of 16 square meters, the wide ResNet 52 achieved the highest accuracy values and outperformed all other networks. And for a search window of 32 square meters, we investigated that 4 neural network architectures achieved the same accuracy on the given dataset, but we decided to take the network in our preceding considerations, which achieved the minimum loss value. In this case, it was AlexNet. Afterwards, we performed a hyperparameter optimization by the utilization of the AX framework. And all results are again summarized in this table. And as you can see, there are 3 columns with different search window sizes, 8 square meters, 16 square meters, and 32 square meters. And in sum, there are 3 important rows, which depict our experiments, first about the data composition, then about the most favorable architecture on each data composition, which we found favorable, and our achieved results after the hyperparameter optimization of the chosen architectures. Here you see for 8 square meters at the beginning, after selecting the most favorable dataset composition, we still had 332 samples wrongly classified. After selecting the best architecture, we still had 222 samples wrongly classified. And now, very interestingly, the hyperparameter optimization led to a huge drop in wrong classified samples. We only had 32 wrongly classified samples, which is 10 times, more than 10 times less at the beginning than compared to the beginning. For a search window size of 16 square meters, there you can see that in the beginning, after selecting the best data composition, we had 57 samples wrongly classified. After choosing the architecture, it was still 34 wrong classifications remaining. And with the hyperparameter optimization, we were capable to drop the error down to only 7 wrong classified samples, which is about 8 times less compared to the beginning. For a search window size of 32 square meters, we figured out that the architecture is also favorable. The most favorable architecture is AlexNet due to the minimum loss and the minimum accuracy.
After the hyperparameter optimization, we had a slightly worse result. We have one sample test data set which is more wrongly classified. But we figure out that there is a huge drop regarding the loss. It's about 5 times. And this is why we choose this hyperparameter optimized version of the architecture for our subsequent development of the sample transfer learning model, which we will see now. First of all, we are loading a tile. In our case, we just assume there is one tile, here shown. It's an area with 32 square meters. We classify it with AlexNet, and we get out a label. In this case, green color denotes that it's landable, and red color denotes that the tile is not landable or not suitable for emergency landing. And we get a confidence value, how confident the network was regarding its prediction. So in this case, 35.4%. Then we ask, we have all tiles processed. If it's not the case, we will take next tile and process it. But in our case, we have only one tile, so we finished this processing step and come to the next processing step. Here we check if we have tiles which have a confidence less than 99%. In our case, it's definitely the case. So if we go to the next step, we grab the necessary data layers, in this case NDVI and slope, feed it in wide ResNet 52 and perform a classification. We get again here some classification, it's landable. We also get a confidence value, how confident was the network about its classification, and we calculate the average confidence from this network and the and AlexNet. And then we ask again, we processed all tiles which have a confidence less than 99%, is not the case, so we perform the same analysis for the next tile and the next tile and the next tile till we processed all tiles. And then we get the patch segmented map as shown here. And the next step is, do we have all tiles processed with a confidence less than 99%? Yes, we have all tiles processed, so we go now to the third step. We analyze now search windows with 8 square meters. We feed it in ResNet. We again perform a classification. We get the confidence about its classification, and we calculate the average confidence from all three networks. And this average confidence about the prediction is what says if this tile is landable or not. We perform again all these predictions for all tiles with a lower average confidence than 99%. And when we have finished, we see some patch-based segmentation as shown as in this figure. And you can see that here after wide ResNet, there was still a piece of path which was classified as landable. We don't want to have paths or streets or something like this for an emergency landing, and therefore it's more visible to have something like here shown. So you see the path is definitely labeled as not landable, and you also see here is some square, and this square don't contain any pixels of the path, so it's clearly landable. And after the third step, it's also decided to be clearly landable. And afterwards, after processing all tiles with lower average confidence than 99%, we finish our algorithm and we have a patch-based segmentation of the whole area. Let's consider some real examples. For example, this shown area. We see we first performed the classification with AlexNet trained on 32 square meters. And as you can see, this path or street, whatever it is wrongly classified. It's classified as landable. But what we wish is something like this. And you see the path after applying our ensemble transfer learning model is definitely more precise, segmented as not landable than it was before. But we figure out that it is not always the case that we have something like this. Sometimes we have some transitions between fields, And for example, this red square, if we more precisely investigate it, this is shown here in figure D. It's a Hilchert representation of the digital surface model of the corresponding red square. And we see there is some line, there is something. And if we take the line profile, we can see here in figure E that that we have a drop in our slope, and we have a very high slope from 70.7%. And this is very unfavorable if you conduct an emergency landing with your airplane and your wheel can stick here in this ditch and your airplane can roll over. And it's very dangerous for all passengers and people inside the aircraft. And as you can see in figure F, you see this ditch here along is classified as landable, which is not good. And therefore we decided to train an elite neural network, which is mainly focused in identifying ditches and fences, because this was mainly the structures which are not correctly classified in our data set. And we applied to the landable areas, and what we find out later is a classification like this. You can see the ditch here is clearly now classified as not landable. And afterwards we apply an emergency landing field identification. The more precise details about the algorithm can be seen in our paper. Let's have a more general view on our results. In this slide, you see on the right side in the figure a more big field of view. And there it's obvious that the emergency landing fields, which are identified, are only fitted where there are no fences and where are no ditches. And this is what we wanted to achieve. On the left side is some information written. In sum, we segmented 247 square kilometers as landable or not landable. Thereby, about 26 square kilometers are classified as landable, and the rest is classified as not suitable for an emergency landing. In sum, we identified about 55,000 emergency landing fields, and the EASA recommends to increase the minimum runway length under the condition of very short wet grass with a firm subsoil by a factor of 1.6, and the minimum required emergency landing field under this condition is still fulfilled by 12,000 emergency landing fields. Let us conclude the presentation. First of all, we saw the different data sets for developed for various search window sizes. Furthermore, we saw that the selection of the best data composition and the RNN architecture, as well as the hyperparameters, heavily influenced the prediction performance of our proposed model. Furthermore, we introduced our hierarchical sample transfer learning model. We figured out that it still have problems by identifying ditches and fences, and therefore we developed an allied artificial neural network which is specially trained for identifying ditches and fences. Furthermore, we segmented about 247 square kilometers into 26 square kilometers which are landable, and the rest of the area is labeled as not landable. In sum, we find about 55,000 emergency landing fields, and furthermore, the recommendations of the EASA for very short wet grass with firm subsoil is still fulfilled by nearly 12,000 emergency landing fields. Left for our future works is the development of our own artificial neural network architectures, the verification of the obstacle clearance of the final approach, and the building of the recommendation system for the most suitable emergency landing fields. Thank you very much for your attention.